It's wonderful to be back here. Thank you so much, Bala sir. It's an honor to be here today. So I was told by your director, ma'am, that I was told about the topic for the theme for your conference. And then we were talking about what is it that I could spend my hour or so with you talking about. And this is what I arrived on. Evolving demographics of the corporate world. I'm guessing you know what demographics is. Can you tell me? I'm sorry? Okay. Can't hear you. Characteristics of a population, fair enough. Characteristics like what? Age, gender, anything else? Culture, all right, nice, nice. So do you think that's really an emerging trend? Haven't we always had people of different age groups and gender and nationalities work together in the office? So why are we calling it evolving demographics of the corporate world today? What's different today as opposed to how the corporate world would have been, say, 15 or 20 years ago? Sorry? Okay, that doesn't change the demographics. The same population churns, right? But how does it impact your demographics? Do you really think that the demographics of organizations are different today than what they used to be many years ago? In what sense? What kind of trend? Right. So those are processes primarily you're talking about, right? But in terms of people, when we're saying demographics, we're talking about the people in the workplace. Is the mix of the people any different today than what it used to be or what you think it used to be? More number of female employees. Oh, yes, absolutely. More women employees in the workplace, more women employees or women students here. Absolutely. That's one. What else has changed? I'm sorry, I didn't hear where that came from. Yeah. Ratio of youth to elder citizens. What has happened? Okay. And why is that? Younger generation is up there. Sure, sure. A lot of things. Absolutely. So I'm going to introduce you to a concept called diversity, which I'm sure you're probably familiar with or you've read about it someplace. So this is diversity. Diversity exists in the workplace. Diversity in terms of all of these parameters, right? So age somebody mentioned, and that's one of the things that I'm going to be talking about in a greater detail during our talk here today, is the diversity in age, which somebody back there also mentioned, right? So there are all kinds of different generations which are simultaneously working in a workplace today, which didn't happen in the past. So we'll talk about what the differences are there. Language. Is language really, is there diversity in language in the workplace, you presume? Yes. Here in your institute, I'm sure there are people from different parts of the country. Is that true?
Yes.
And that's how every organization in the country today is, where it's a mix of people from different parts of the nation, in fact, even people from different parts of the world, right? Many, many years ago, when we didn't have this kind of diversity, if you were to work in an organization in Chennai, you could very well just have all your communication in Tamil because everybody there would be speaking Tamil. Or if you were to, you know, set up a business in Haryana, everyone would speak the language there and so on. But that's not the case anymore. Wherever you go, if in fact Bangalore today has got a sizable North Indian population because of the IT sector and so on, right? So there is a lot of movement, there is a lot of diversity in terms of the language and the culture that the language brings along with it in the workplace. Personality styles, which we'll talk about in greater detail because that's where we are heading to, right? So all of us, depending on our backgrounds, depending on the age group, our gender, and so on and so forth, and our inherent preferences, we bring in a different personality style along with us to the workplace, which is all different, right? race, ethnicity is not such a big concern for us when you're working inside of India for an Indian organization, but it becomes a big concern the moment you start interacting with people outside the country. And if you're working for a multinational corporation, which in all likelihood I'm guessing many of you would end up doing very soon, you would have to work with people who are of different races, who are from different countries, different nationalities, and you'll have to know how to interact with them, right? Gender, of course, we spoke of differing abilities, origin, sexual orientation, beliefs, occupation, different education and experiences, every social economic background, culture. So there are all these are different aspects of diversity, and all of this kind of comes together in the workplace when you interact with people. If you notice in this graphic, in the center is you. So when you're in the workplace, you're actually interacting with people with varied backgrounds on each of these parameters, which are different from your own. It's easier to associate with people who are similar to you, right? But when you have to work in teams, you have to work with people who are very different from you for all of these reasons, which are hardwired into the person, it becomes extremely challenging. If you don't have the right attitude, it becomes extremely challenging to work with them, okay? Okay, so essentially all of these things, all these aspects that we looked at, all of these things together is what comes to be known as corporate culture or, you know, an organization's culture or a company culture. You've heard these terms before? Yes, we talk about I'm sure you talk about corporate culture here because Bala sir used to talk about that all the time when we were students, right? So that's what the culture essentially is, a mix of all of these things. There's this gentleman called Geert Hofstede. Hofstede came up with this model called the Hofstede model of culture, right? And he says that there are differences, and he worked with IBM in the early, I think, 1940s, 1950s. He used to work with IBM at one point, and he worked with people from different nationalities. His initial survey was to work with people from 40 different nationalities, and he came up with this model saying that people are different. Depending on whichever country of origin you come from, every person has a different preference. And those preferences can be mapped in terms of these five indexes that he came up with. So the first is called the power distance index, okay? Now it's quite possible that in some cultures, the power distance index is large. What that means is that if there is a person in authority, they are revered. Whatever the boss says, the person listens to and understands, right? If what the parent says, the children listen to and adhere by it without questioning it. That is when you have a large gap in the power distance index. When you have a small gap between the power distance index, you have equal opinions. You have opportunities for everyone. Everybody gets to have an opinion. The child gets to have an opinion about where the family is going for a picnic and things like that, right? In a workplace, the employees get to weigh in on policy decisions in terms of this is the policy, this suits us fine, and this doesn't suit us. Right. So in terms of cultures, which kind of culture do you think is more when it comes to, you know, a larger power distance index? Which countries do you think would display a larger power distance index? Korea, yes, to a great extent now, yes. China, yes. Where would you put India? Would India be a very short power distance index? Where is it? Is it very large? Where are we? Third. What is third? Somewhere in the middle? Fair. Absolutely. Absolutely. Cultures like in the US is where the distance is very, very small, where, you know, everybody is treated as equally and so on. I mean, the CEO could be having coffee with the janitor and things like that. That would never happen in China. It may possibly happen that the CEO and the janitor exchange glances and a smile in India. So we are halfway there, right? So absolutely. Individualism versus collectivism. This is again something that he came up with. He said that there are certain culture where it's all about the individual. You know, this is what I want to do. This is what works for me. This is my career, my life. you know, my immediate family and so on. And the collectivism model is more in terms of the group, the culture of where I come from, my larger family, my joint family, and things like that. In this sense, where do we fit in? Where's India when it comes to this? Are we really? Are we like fully collectivism today or partially? So we are moving, right? And again, the generational shift. Your parents' generation, probably collectivism might have been true. I don't know. Your grandparents' generation, for sure, collectivism was how India was. But now we are seeing more and more individualism happen in India as well. How many of you are very sure that you're going to pick up the job that suits you best and not what, you know, other people tell you to do or what your parents advise you to do? You'll pick up there, all the hands going up. So that's individualism, isn't it? You'll move to a different city, you'll live by yourself, you'll do what you have to do, that is individualism. If it were collectivism, you would have gone back to whichever state, city that you come from and you would have lived close-knit with your families. That would have been your logical choice, not anymore. So we are shifting when it comes to this aspect also. Masculinity versus femininity, this is an interesting one. So some cultures are masculine by nature. What do you think that means? What's a masculine culture? Male dominated, and what does that mean? How can a culture be masculine? Sorry? Thank you, that's a good one. The structure is rigid. It is authoritarian in nature, right? And it is very, very achievement focused. When a culture is achievement focused, it is termed as a masculine culture, where you have a goal, you set your targets, and you achieve that goal no matter what, right? A feminist culture, on the other hand, is more accommodating. A feminist culture is one where, you know, you not only look at who is strong, you also look at who is weak, and you try and help that person out, right? Rather than just focusing. A masculine culture is where all the focus is only on who is strong. Everybody follows the strong leader. In a feminist culture, everyone's trying to help out everyone. A masculine culture typically has what somebody said, male-dominated. So a picture of that is a household where the husband works, the wife is the housewife, and the wife's job is to take care of the children. In a feminine culture, both husband and wife are equally responsible for the finances. Both husband and wife are equally responsible for the upbringing of the children. That's more of a feminist culture. Where are we today? Moving towards feminine, yeah, femininity, yeah, absolutely, absolutely, yes. Again, so you will notice as we go through it that India is in a flux. There is a lot of change that is happening to us. It has been happening for the past decade or so, and it's, the rate of that change is only increasing. It's happening faster and faster. The next one is uncertainty avoidance. Now, I don't know if Hofstede had India in mind when he came up with that parameter, but it fits us just perfectly. So uncertainty avoidance means that certain cultures like certainty, which means that if you say that something will happen at 6 o'clock, it will happen at 6 o'clock. If something has to be done in a certain way, it will be done in a certain way. And then there are cultures where uncertainty is accepted. You know, it's all about if it happens, it will happen. If it somehow it will happen. We don't know how it's going to happen and things like that. Where is India, you think? Certainty culture, India, really? Well, we hope to get there at some point. But we're like hardwired as a nation into the whole uncertainty culture. You've heard of the term jugaad? We have a term for uncertainty. That's how rampant that is in our system. Everything is about ho jayega. We'll figure out. Don't worry. Nahin ho jayega, sir. Right? It's somehow we get around all the obstacles. We figure out a way. That's where we belong. But if an answer like that, a response like that will shock an American, you know, and that happens in the workplace all the time. So this is one conflict that we have to deal with on a regular basis. When you have projects of people who are working across countries, right? When an Indian team member says, there is a problem, I know there is a problem, we'll have it fixed by Monday. How will you fix it? Don't worry, sir, we'll fix it. Right? And only the Indian knows how he's going to fix it. In all likelihood, he's going to fix it. But the Americans are scared when they hear answers like this. Because they would like to know the plan. Okay, how are you going to fix it? What are the steps that you're going to do? How are you going to get there? How will you ensure that it'll get done and so on? So we are very, very deep-rooted as a culture in uncertainty, but we are making that transition to become more and more certain in the things that we do. And finally, there is long-term versus short-term orientation. So some cultures are more long-term oriented, which means that they will plan 10 years, 15 years into the future. Some cultures are more short-term, which means they're looking at what's immediate. Where are we? Traditionally, yes. Where are you guys? So what does that tell you? The generation. Right? So the way the generations are shifting, the focus or the culture of our country as a whole is shifting, and which is reflected in the workplace that we have in India today. All right? And these are, I'm going to skip through this bit because I've already spoken to you about this. Do you guys share the presentation with everyone? Do you do that? Yeah, so you will have this. Please read through whenever you find the time or are curious enough. All right, this I want to talk to you about. So whatever we've discussed so far about the culture piece of it is only the tip of the iceberg, right? Which means that what's a characteristic trait of an iceberg? Yeah, so some say 20, some say 10, whatever. So say, let's say 1/10 of it is visible and 9/10 of it is below the surface. So whatever you see in terms of culture happening around you, it's only the 1/10 that you're seeing, which means it's the behavior that you get to see. Why people behave in a certain way, right? What you don't get to see is where that behavior is actually coming from. It's coming from their beliefs, coming from their values and things like that, which is all hardwired into us based on a lot of different reasons. Now, the behavior, like I said, is visible, and it denotes the external culture that we see happening around us. But there is also something called internal culture, which is the values, the beliefs which are guiding the internal culture of a person. So each one of you, there is an internal culture that you live with. And whichever environment you're in, you're exposed to the external culture of that environment. If the external culture of that environment suits your internal culture, you will thrive in that culture. If it doesn't, some changes would need to take place on either side. Either you alter the culture outside, or you modify or adapt to the newer culture that you're exposed to. These are a few things about these. So external culture is explicitly learned, which means that you can learn these things, right? You are told that this is what you, for example, let us say that you pick up a job in the US, right? There would be certain things about your internal culture that you might need to adopt, you might need to change. There will be a lot of things about your external culture that you would have to change, right? Using certain types of cutlery or being exposed to certain kind of food or whatever it is, you know, certain work etiquettes, you will have to make those changes, consciously make those changes in your habits. So these are conscious. The internal culture piece is mostly unconscious. You don't even realize that it's kind of impacting how you're interacting with people, how you come across to people and things like that. External culture can be changed easily. So it's very easy to tell someone that, hey, tomorrow onwards, please start doing this, and it's easy for them to adapt. But I can't tell you tomorrow onwards, start thinking like this. So your internal culture is a lot more difficult to change as opposed to the external one. One is objective and the other is a lot more subjective. Okay, there is something called frame of reference. Are you familiar with this concept? Ever heard of something called frame of reference, anybody? Can you tell me what it is? Good. Absolutely. So, do we view things differently based on who we are? Can two people look at the same thing differently?
Yeah.
That happens. Has anybody bought a car or a bike recently here? Anybody? Any vehicle? Here, back home? All right, which one? You bought an Activa 4G. Which color?
Metallic?
Gray. Metallic gray. When did you buy it?
1 month ago.
So after you bought your metallic gray Activa 4G, did you find a lot more of metallic gray Activa 4Gs on the street? Yeah, or maybe they just got popular because you bought it. Are you sure? Has that happened to anybody else? You know, you think of buying something. It could be a phone, it could be a vehicle, it could be anything. The moment you think about buying it, suddenly you see a lot more of it all around. It's not that it suddenly got popular because you decided to buy it. Then what happened? We start seeing it a lot more, right? Which means that we see what we want to see. We don't always see the things that are in front of us. We always see the things that we want to see. Often people say that seeing is believing. The reverse is also true, which means that believing is seeing. When you start believing something, you start seeing it. A frame of reference acts in the same way. A frame of reference means that, you know, you look at something and you say that everything passes through your filter, right? I believe that people of a certain community are like this. So no matter what they do, I will see them like that. I believe that people from a different country, all Chinese people act like this, I will see that all the time. Right? So things like this, this is our frame of reference. And each one of us has this frame of reference that is operational all the time. It's a valuable tool for understanding ourselves and others as well. So once you start understanding your frame of reference, you'll start understanding yourself better and you'll start understanding other people better as well. We're going to do an exercise now. So what I want you to do is reflect. And that's what the picture is up for. So many of you are already with your eyes closed and in deep meditation. So you can continue that. When you do that, I want you to think about any one, okay, one frame of reference or let's call it one stereotype that you have kind of internalized about people in the workplace, a different generation person in the workplace. So all of you are which generation, do you know that? Gen? Gen I, okay. Why? Why? Or I? Or millennials? We'll see. We'll see in just a bit. But whichever generation you're or you think you belong to, you might have some perceptions of people from the earlier generations who are in the workplace. What are those perceptions? Write down one thing that you believe is different about them than you. Can you write that on a piece of paper? One thing that you believe is different about the earlier generation as compared to who you are. Any one thing, just one sentence. And everybody has to write it down right now. One thing, come on guys, it shouldn't take you that long. Just one thing. Are you done writing? Yeah. You're still writing, all right. Who's done writing? Could you please read out what you've written?
We are
more fearless and more risk-taking than the earlier generation, all right, thank you very much. Yes, please. You're more hyperactive, all right? More enthusiastic, thank you. Anybody else? More open to changes? Tech savvy, thank you. More technical, techno-savvy, all right? Use of technology. I've heard that thrice already, okay? What else? More opportunity-oriented, all right? Vis-a-vis what? The earlier guys were... Sure. More about your personal career ambitions. Fair enough. Yes, ma'am? Less patient, yes? Clothing has... Well, yeah, but in the workplace, you got to wear what you got to wear. But yeah, all right, taken. Yes, ma'am. Adaptable, that's nice. Self-centered. More egoistic than the older generation. All right, thank you. Last one. Yes, ma'am, go ahead. Money was time and time. All right, yes, ma'am. Absolutely. All right. Wonderful. And I'm sure everybody else, you've written at least one thing down. Have you all?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, what seeker? Opportunity seeker. All right. Nice. Now, whichever hand you wrote the statement with, use your other hand and write the same statement just below it. So if you're right-handed, now use your left hand. If you're left-handed, now use your right hand. And write it again just below what you've written. Go ahead. Now you wish you had made shorter sentences, don't you? How did it feel? Are you done writing? How did it feel to use your other hand? Difficult. Okay. Anything else? Difficult? Any other feelings? Did you find it impossible, anyone? So it's possible. But it's difficult. Is that right? Does that sum up the feeling and emotion that everybody went through? More or less, I heard a no. So what was the other feeling? Not difficult? Not difficult, all right, nice. Now, imagine this. God forbid something happens to your, you know, dominant hand. Let's say for a few months. Okay, and you can't use this hand to write for the next few months. Do you think you can use your other hand? And will you improve the skill of that hand if you are using it for, let's say, you know, you're normally right-handed and now you've started using your left hand and you have to use it for 6 months. Will you be able to write easily using your left hand then? Yes? With practice, you would be able to? Which means you're learning a new skill even though it doesn't come to you naturally. Correct? And when after 6 months, let's say your hand was in a cast and after 6 months the cast comes out, would you prefer writing with your right hand or your left hand? Well, whichever is your... Would you go back to your dominant hand or would you continue writing with the newly acquired skill hand? But then you, after that, okay, stay with me here. After that, when you get into a situation where you have to use either, would you be comfortable using either hand?
Yes.
That's a lot like what you're going to face when you enter the workplace. Because you have certain things which come naturally to you, being part of a certain generation, being part of a certain, you know, where you grew up or what your background is and your gender and whatnot, all those things that we saw on the wagon wheel initially, right? So there are certain things that will come to you naturally, and certain things will be learned behavior. One way of doing it is dismissing it off and saying that, you know, this is wrong. Nobody should ever write with the left hand. Everyone should write with the right hand, which is one way of looking at what you will go through in the workplace and saying that this is the right way to do it and everybody else is wrong. And the other is to adapt. It will be difficult initially, but you can pick up that skill and you can learn that skill. Do you agree? Yeah? So few assumptions that kind of work for us when you look at how culture is built and how our preferences kind of come out in place. Preferences are inborn, which means that you are born with certain preferences for all those characteristics that you just spoke of. You know, tech savvy, for example, is not something that you have learned. It's something that you were born with. Are you aware of that? Your earlier generations, when they get your grandparents or, I know, older parents, right? When they get a new device, a mobile phone or something, have you seen them struggle with it? And have you seen a six-year-old or a seven-year-old of today easily navigate the same phone with zero experience of doing it in the past? Have you seen that? So your tech-savvy skill is not something that you have developed or created. It's something that you're born with. That is something that has happened over a course of time due to evolution. Right? So those are inborn. And everything else in terms of your preferences, in terms of, you know, individuation versus collectivism and so on, all of those things are your natural inborn preferences. Another thing we are saying is, once I understand the preferences of a particular group, or you understand the preferences of the groups, either for yourself or the other groups that you interact with, you can predict their behavior. So in a workplace, I know in a given situation how a millennial will react as opposed to how a Gen X person will react as opposed to, say, how a baby boomer is going to react in that situation, right? So when you understand all of these things, you can actually predict how people tend to behave. And same goes for personality styles and things like that. If you understand, are there HR specialization folks in here? Are you guys familiar with MBTI, Myers-Briggs type indicator? Yeah, so Carl Jung, whose work this came up with, Jung spoke about this. He says that, you know, preferences are inborn and behavior is predictable. So if you understand someone's personality type, you can predict their behavior in various situations. The other thing we are saying is there is no best way to be. It is not that, you know, my style is the best style of working or somebody else's style is the best style of working. We don't know, right? There is no one good style. Preferences are not the same as skill, and that's what you just experienced. Your preference was to write with your right hand or whichever is your dominant hand, but it's not really the same as skill. Skill is something that you can pick up. So if, like I said, if you were not allowed to use that hand, you will pick up the skill of writing with another hand. The only difference here is preferences are what come to the fore when you have a free rein, which means that there is no governing force, there is nothing, you can do whatever you want to do, then your natural preference comes out. But in the corporate world, in the workplace, there are governing, you know, rules and there are processes and there are policies that govern our behavior, which means that you will have to look at adapting your natural preferences to whatever is the environment, depending on where you choose to work. It's also not an excuse. You cannot use your preference as an excuse saying that, you know what, I am like this, but I can't help it, I'm from this generation, or I can't help it, I'm from this country, and so on, right? You cannot use that as an excuse. They are dynamic, which means they change over a period of time. All the things that people bring to the organization, to the workplace, all the skills are equally valuable to the organization. People are hired for the diversity that they bring into the system, right? Environment impedes or enhances. Expression means that given the right circumstances, you know, you will be able to express your natural preferences a lot better in certain situations you can't. for example, this environment in this room right now, it kind of impedes a lot of your expression at the moment, right? If we weren't over here, right now your natural preference would have been to do something else. But the environment makes you do things in a certain way, and you're able to do it. This is a learned behavior for you. It's a learned skill. When you started off over here, when you guys are all final year guys, second year? Yeah, so when you joined in last year, you weren't like this. This is learned skill for you of sitting in an auditorium for 10 hours, 12 hours is not something that you've done during your graduation or before that, right? So we can pick up these things if that's what the environment demands us to do. All right, now let's talk about the generations that we were having that conversation about earlier as to which generation. Now there are different definitions and different timelines that you will find for generations. After a lot of research, this is the one that I narrowed in on because it kind of consecutively repeats the theme. So there are traditionalists or the silent generation. I'm not sure if it's visible back there, so I'm going to read it out to you. People born either on or before 1945 are called the traditionalists. Okay? Their current status, ages 72 and above. So most of them are out of the active workforce today. There are still a few in the workplace, but most of them are outside the active workplace. Baby boomers, people born between 1946 to 1964. Today, they would be aged between 53 and 71. They are still very much around in the workplace. Most CXO level positions are occupied by baby boomers. Okay, most CXO level. There are also younger CEOs, etc., who are of the next generation. But in traditional organizations, mostly you'll find that the CXOs are there. Senior leadership positions in most organizations are held by baby boomers. Most functional heads, you know, department heads and all of that, these positions are all typically held by the baby boomer generations. Okay? And they're very different. Each generation is very different from the other. Okay? So you need to learn and understand about the baby boomer generation. Would most of your parents fit into this generation based on this age group? So you've seen people of this generation, right? Are they different in terms of their work ethics, work style as compared to how you're going to be? What are the characteristics of this generation, you think? Very hardworking, yes. What else? Very punctual. Very disciplined, okay. Not very adaptable, true that, yes. Take time in making, it has to be thorough, need all the data before they'll come up with a decision. Very true. And then you have the Gen X. Gen X is people born between 1965 to 1980. Ages 37 to 52 at the moment. Quite a few CXO level positions are occupied by Gen X also today, because it's that age group between 37 to 52. So many of the CXO level positions, many senior leadership positions, especially in younger organizations like, you know, startups and things would be even lesser than that. But typically the bulk of the population you will find is in the middle management in organizations today. What is this generation like? Do you know people of this generation? What is this generation like, you think? In all likelihood, when you join in, they would be your immediate managers. So you better know this generation. What would they be like? Okay. Less rigid than the baby boomers, okay. Anything else? Okay, so if the facts support a particular decision that they need to make a change, they will, all right. Anything else that you know about this generation? So this generation was actually labeled as the rebel generation. So where the earlier one, the baby boomers were extremely rigid in terms of how they wanted to get things done in a certain way and all of that, the Gen X came as the opposite to that, wherein they wanted to do everything very, very differently. They are much more casual in their work style, how they would like to deal with things and all of that. The way organizations started moving. So in India especially, this is the generation which has lived through the whole liberalization of 1991. You all read about it? Yes? So this is the generation that was actually around to witness the liberalization happening. They are the ones who've seen maximum change. They are the ones who moved from watching one Doordarshan to, you know, getting like 20 channels and things like that. And, you know, getting the first McDonald's and the first pizza outlet and all of that. That's this generation. So they're very, very adaptable to what's coming their way and things like that. Yet they retain certain values of the earlier generation because they started their careers with the earlier generation on the top. Okay? So that's your Gen X. And then you have the millennials, or which is also referred to as the Gen Y. This is people born between 1981 to 1995. Is everybody in this room, or the students in this room, are you all fitting into this category, or do you have people? So you're not millennials. Whoa, see? And so many of you said millennials. Between 1981 to 1995? All of you? Nobody born after 95? See? Yeah. So what are you guys then? Absolutely. Gen Z or the iGen or the Centennials. This is the latest generation that is around. Good to see you guys. Welcome. Yeah. So today we are at a point where this generation is just starting off. So most of the new employees that are joining the organizations today, fresh out of college, especially graduate engineers and things like that, are mostly Gen Z. Many of you, so you are here, you are a mix of millennials and Gen Z, which again, these two generations are separate and different from each other. They don't have the same preferences, they don't have the same attitudes, they don't have the same approach towards all the things, including work. Yeah? So what are the characteristics of your generation, whichever you are, whether you're a millennial or a Gen Z? What do you think are the characteristics? Aggressive, experimenting, okay. Innovative, all right. Lazy, thank you. Yeah, that's something genuine coming up, finally. You're curious, all right. So, see, everything in terms of how you approach a lot of things, this changes, depending on how you... For example, one of the things could be baby boomers was a generation where it was a value to put in extra hours at work. If you spent 10 hours in the office, you were a good person. You would get promoted if you were spending 10 hours, 11 hours in the office every day. They'll promote you just for that. And then came along Gen X, which said that, hey, that doesn't make any sense. I will work only for 8 hours and then I will balance my, you know, family life. So the work-life balance phrase, that kind of started with Gen X. They were kids of the earlier generation. So they had been through the hard side. Their preference was to spend time with their family. They would overcompensate, taking family for holidays and things like that. That's Gen X. By the time the millennials have entered the workforce, the term work-life balance is kind of losing its sheen. What's happening more is a work-life blend. What do you think is the difference between a work-life balance and a work-life blend? Which is what your generation is mostly bringing to the workplace. And a mess out of it? Yeah. But that's what's happening. So that's what the millennials are doing today is a work-life blend, which means that they don't mind working at 11 in the night from home or working over the weekend from home. But even when they are at work, they don't mind doing some online shopping when they're sitting at their desk. They don't mind that either. You know, so that's the blend that we're talking about. So they're okay stepping out from the office to catch up with some friends, then come back to the office and resume their work. So they'll kind of blend it in, and which is working, which is a culture which is picking up today, which is absolutely fine, right? So things like these, so there are these smaller nuances, smaller things where you will observe the change in the mindset of people from different generations, how they approach different situations and so on. A few interesting stats that I managed to pick up is here, and mostly it talks about the Gen Z and the millennials. Now look at the Gen Z. This is how you feel about yourself, okay? 42% of Gen Z feels that social media has a direct impact on how they feel about themselves. 42% of the Gen Z people believe that social media has an impact on how they felt about themselves, as opposed to just 20% with the baby boomers, or 31% with the millennials. Do you guys think this is true? Does social media really have an impact on how you think about yourself? Well, that's what the survey says. That's the difference between the earlier generation and this generation. And there is more around social media. 42% of Gen Z also responded that they felt social media affects how other people see them. So how others see me is also based on the social media. 42% of Gen Z believes that how others see me is a reflection of, or how I come across on social media is how others see me. It's not my regular interactions with people, as opposed to only 28% of what the older generation gave weightage to that. And there's more. About phone habits again. Now this is interesting. So Gen Z is 50% less likely than older generation to say it is appropriate to talk, text, and surf the web during work hours. It's the older generations that are taking personal calls and, you know, doing all that in during work hours. Gen Z says that it's not okay to do that. When you're at work, you should focus on work. But nearly twice as likely to think it's appropriate to talk on your mobile phone during a job interview. Have you thought about that? Yeah, so that I definitely don't agree by. So when your campus placements start and you're in the middle of an interview, please don't answer your mobile phone, right? Despite what the generational trend tells you about, that's something that I think you should avoid. Phone etiquette, another interesting snippet there about phone etiquette. While Gen Z said use of a phone was acceptable in almost any occasion, while eating dinner with the family, during a religious service, on job interview, applying for a home loan, on a dinner date, and even at their own wedding, they are actually more reserved than older generations about personal phone usage in the workplace. Yeah, you nod to that, okay. So these are things which, now this is where the challenge of the different generations kind of comes in. These are things which your older generations that we spoke of, the Gen X's who you would be reporting into, and the baby boomers who are already there in CEO positions, these are things that they can't get their head around. They can't understand why would you pick up your phone call in the middle of a board review meeting, right? And they totally lose it on that. And even random smaller things like, so if you're not coming into work, you're not feeling well, you would drop in a WhatsApp message to your manager. Those are things that are not taken very nicely even today, not by people of the earlier generation, right? Within, if your boss is a millennial, by all means, you know, you would have a WhatsApp group in which you can just say not coming in today and everyone will be okay with it. Probably you'll get a high five for it, but that's not how it works when you're dealing with people from different generations. And those are the things that you need to keep in mind when you're interacting with people from different generations, right? Okay, one place where everybody agrees, 100%. So real-time mobile comparison shopping, which means that when you're shopping for a product out there, you know, you would go in and look at the price on your mobile phone. Every generation does that. 100%. You do that, you know, the earlier ones, even your parents do that today. Every generation, before making a purchase, all of them agree on certain things. So there are things that people are adapting to, they are learning from as time passes by. It would be wrong for anyone to stay rigid and say, you know, just like I'm telling you guys that, you know, you need to adapt to what the earlier generation is expecting of you. Similarly, the earlier generation is also adapting to whatever makes sense to them with what's coming in the new world. And I have a personal example there. So when I started my first car, right, I had an audio cassette player, something like this, in my car. Have you ever used one of these?
Yes,
sir. Oh, wow. I didn't expect you guys to use these. In fact, we spent, when we were kids, we spent a lot of our money buying these tapes, right? So I had this huge collection of audio cassettes, which would play just fine in my car stereo. And then technology changed and this came along, the USB drive. And then I was like, wow, you know, this can't get any better. Now I don't need to carry my audio cassettes, plus it's free. I don't need to buy cassettes anymore. So I can just download music from anywhere, put it on a pen drive and listen to any music whenever I want, right? So it didn't get any better than that. And then this happened. So now you don't even need a pen drive. And you don't need to store in songs there, which means that at any point in time, whatever music I feel like listening to, my phone, which is plugged into my car stereo now, will play it for me, right? So that's change, that's adapting to the new technology and loving it. So that's a good thing, right? But similarly, you will also have to make some changes to adapt to what happened to your earlier generations in terms of, you know, what their work styles are, what their work cultures are, so on. So it has to be a two-way street. Because ultimately, we all have to work together in one workplace and have to work together well. So a few tips here before I part. Navigating this demographic potpourri, where you have people of all different races, castes, religions, gender, working together, right? So there's a lot of things that are happening. A few things that you could keep in mind to navigate your way through this. Have a positive attitude and resist the urge to complain. It would be very natural to complain against somebody else whose behavior or whose preferences are different from yours. Why does my boss always print out a document before a meeting? Why is he wasting paper? Well, yeah, you can bring that up, but they do that. Right, so things like that, it's easier to understand where it's coming from rather than to complain about it. This for your generation is of utmost importance. Your reputation precedes you. This includes social media, right? So be very sure of what you want to project in terms of a social media image, because I'm sure you're aware of this already. Some of you might have done your internships in HR and recruitments. You would know that when we look at a candidate's profile today, we look at the resume and we also look at whatever social media presence is available for the person. Invariably, you'll scan through the LinkedIn. If possible, you'll also look at their Facebook, right? So that is something that happens very regularly. So please be sure that, you know, you're presenting the image that you want to present. Nothing is hidden, nothing is, you know, protected from the view outside. Be flexible and embrace the unexpected. So when you start off, you will be thrown to a lot of different circumstances, situations. People will think in their own way and demand things in their own way. Be prepared for that. You've all done your internships already?
Yes,
sir. So you've got a first-hand feel of all of this, I presume. How the boss comes in at 5 o'clock and says, I want this done now. Yeah? So those kind of things happen, right? Watch your language. Important tip. Casual language, your casual chat language has to stay out of the workplace, no matter what that workplace is, right? So there is this line, you cannot cross that line at any point. So please be wary of, and the reason I put this out there is, it is ever so often that millennials and now Gen Z would end up using kind of language which is not acceptable in the workplace, not just in verbal communication, but also over emails. So that's something that you need to probably be aware of. Unplug and engage. It is okay if you don't check your WhatsApp every 5 minutes. Nothing will happen. Right? So try that out. Seriously, the world doesn't come to an end. Yeah, you don't have to log on to your Insta or your Facebook every 10 minutes, 15 minutes and check what's happening. Just when you're engaged somewhere, unplug and engage. Don't be constantly in the need to connect with the world outside. Try and connect with people who are in front of you, rather. If you want to leave work early, tell your boss. This is something that the newer generations find it very difficult. You know, they just decide that it's time for me to go, so I'll leave. But that's something that doesn't sit well with the earlier lot. So if you want to leave early, by all means, tell your boss and leave early. And there's going to be a lot of challenge that's getting thrown your way because of all of these changes. Embrace the challenge. That's what we have to say. Yeah? I'll leave you with this quote from Jim Morrison. Was relevant for my generation, was relevant for my previous generation, and I think this is going to stay relevant for a long time to come. This is what Morrison says. The most important kind of freedom is to be what you really are. You trade in your reality for a role. You trade in your sense for an act. You give up your ability to feel and in exchange put on a mask. There can't be any large-scale revolution until there's a personal revolution. On an individual level, it's got to happen inside first. Yeah? So focus on yourself. Focus on the changes that you want to bring in from within. And everything else in the world will keep changing. Generations will come and go. The workplaces will evolve. All kinds of people will be there. But as long as you know, you're sure about yourself, you understand yourself, and you're clear about what you want to achieve, everything else falls in place. That is all I had for you. Thank you so much. Thank you.